seems like only yesterday, that I was in front of my TV watching the events in New York City with the attacks that was aimed at our people. That had been 21 years ago. We still feel the effects of that vicious attack. You know, one of the things that happened in that brief period of time was that we became united as a people. I mean, for the first time, it wasn't Democrat or Republican, it wasn't black or white. We were Americans. We were joined together. As good as that was, of course, it came out of that tragedy. It's sad that it takes a tragedy to bring us together like that. But that was 21 years ago. So today we do think about that moment in history whenever our world was shaken with the attacks in New York. If you would, open your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. I'm going to read verses 13 through 15. Watch, stand fast in the faith, be brave, be strong. Let all that you do be done with love. I urge you, brethren, you know the household of Stephanas, that it is the first fruits of Achaia, that they have devoted themselves to the ministry of the saints. We're going to talk tonight briefly about things that a Christian does. Now, there is 5 points here that we're going to look at, plus one. It's kind of an addenda. But there's 5 points. You know, a lot of people look at Christianity as something that is passive. It's not passive. Christianity is very active. And it is even aggressive. We are not just content to watch the world go by on the sidelines. We want in the battle. And there is a battle. It's not the battle for the security of our nation like 21 years ago. It's a battle, a struggle for one's eternal life, for the conquering of good over evil, for truth over false doctrine. We want to look at these 5 things tonight, starting in verse 13. Notice, watch, watch. You know, in football, you got to keep your head on a swivel. Nothing hurts any worse than to be blindsided. If you don't see the opposition coming and they put a helmet right on your side or the side of your head, watch. Look around. Make sure. It's a defensive posture. The sentry stands guard. His job is to watch and report anything that comes his way that could be threatening or a danger. We understand this and see this often in our modern military, but yet so many times in the New Testament, Paul uses this phraseology. Even Jesus uses phraseology. Watch. You know, first of all, we're to watch over the souls of those around us. Now, we understand that's the responsibility of the elders. In Acts, the 20th chapter, verse 28, says, take heed of yourselves. First of all, watch over yourself, elder. Take heed of yourselves and of those which the Holy Spirit hath made you overseers. So as overseers of the flock, he goes on to say, and feed the church which he has purchased with his own blood. So we are to watch over the church, and we are to feed it. A good, healthy diet of truth. Watch. Now, each other. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in fault, ye who are spiritual, restore such a one in meekness. Lest yourself also be tempted. You know, when we look at others, we see faults in them, and sometimes those faults we see in them really are faults that we possess. So we need to be very careful when we try to correct those faults. Like Jesus said, if you're trying to get the dirt or speck of dust out of a brother's eye and you've got a two before out of your eye, that's not a good situation. Those of you who are spiritual, you help that brother that's been overtaken. Now, spiritual is one who lives according to the Word of God. We watch for the return of Christ because we don't know when He'll return. You know, Jesus said, if you knew when the thief was coming, you'd prepare for him, right? Sure we would. But the thief didn't call and make arrangements for his coming. The thief doesn't come when you expect it. He comes sometimes when you're not home or you're asleep at night. Now, Jesus compares his coming to that thief. Not that he's here to rob or steal, but it's his return. And we need to be watching. Have you ever thought about the wisdom of God or Christ? Pardon me. Not revealing when Jesus is returning. I mean, he knows men. Man would wait to the last minute to change his ways before the Lord comes. This way, he gets to make a choice. Do you love him enough to prepare for his coming ahead of time? Or are you going to reject him? That's the two choices we're given. We watch for the return of Christ. We don't know what hour the Lord is returning. Matthew 24:42. The parable of the 10 virgins. You know what happened? 5 was prepared, 5 unprepared. And while they was trying to prepare, the bridegroom came. Took the 5 prepared into the chambers. The other 5, the door was shut. You see, we've got to be prepared for when he comes. There'll be no time to prepare after he comes. Revelation 3, verse 3. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard, hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. Watch. Be watchful. You know, the problem is, like in the days of Peter, people are at the point, well, he hasn't come yet, so he's not coming. Or maybe he's not coming in my lifetime. We don't know. Do we have any guarantee that he won't come within the next 24 hours? Any guarantee whatsoever? That's why we prepare. For when he does come. So, number one, we watch. Number two, stand fast. Don't back up. For who is God except the Lord? Who is a rock except God? God is our rock. We want to take position of strength and hold that position. Therefore, we find the rock. And I'm not talking about the actor, the rock. I'm talking about the rock, which is God. And we take our stand on the rock. In Luke 21:34, Jesus warned, "But take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, that day may come upon you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man." To be able to stand with Christ. Philippians 4 verse 13. "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." For 40-something years, that has kind of been my motto. I used to have it, especially when I was at Preston Road, it was on my mirror. Then when I started preaching, it was on my mirror. It's been on my refrigerator, but it's always in my heart. Because I'm here to tell you, there's a lot of things that's happened in my life that I could not have handled without the strength of Christ. He is the one that has empowered me, whether we're talking about in my physical life or my spiritual life. He gives me the power to stand fast. And of course, in Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verse 10, we're to adorn the whole armor of God. "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places." We're not fighting flesh and blood. It's what makes this fight so difficult. It's a spiritual fight. It's a fight that could cost us our souls. And we can't even see the enemy. But we see the effects of the enemy. We know of the temptations that comes our way. We see the attacks that affronts us. So we must stand fast. You know, sometimes it takes a lot of strength to stand fast. And I know that's one of my points here in a minute. Galatians 2 verse 11. "Now when Peter had come to Antioch, I withstood him face to face because he was to be blamed. Now I want you to think about this. Here's two friends. The Bible tells us that Paul saw something in Peter that he didn't like. And he came to Peter and withstood him to the face. Now here is the youngest of all the apostles. I don't mean in age, but I mean in time. And he's confronting a man who had been associated with Jesus. And because he had left the table of the Gentiles because of the entrance of the Jews, Paul confronted him. And he would not let him get away with it. Sometimes we have to take a stand, even with people closest to us. In Galatians 2, verse 14, watch this. Talking about this event where the Jews left the table of the Greeks. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, if you, being a Jew, live in the manner of Gentiles and not as the Jews, why do you compel the Gentiles to live as Jews? Now, Paul refers to this as not being straightforward to the gospel. Their attitude toward the Gentiles in front of the Jews. And so he corrected them. You know, that took some strength on the part of our friend Paul to confront Peter. Jude 3, contend earnestly for the faith which once and for all was delivered to the saints. Contend earnestly for the faith. You know, faith has been under attack for a long time. And we must stand on that rock, firm and fast, and defend the faith. A lot of people want to ignore it. Ignore the attacks. We can't do that. We have ignored it for way too long. We are where we are now is because good people did nothing. Stand fast on the rock. Be brave. Brave. That's just a word, isn't it? Oh, such an important word. Brave in the truth. Ephesians 4:14, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, even Christ. Being brave like David. In 1 Samuel 17, Israel was fighting the Philistines, if you want to call it that. Every time Goliath would step to the forefront and offer his challenge, Israel fell back. Fell back. Oh, I know. Goliath had to be intimidating. He had to be. He was a giant. The weaver's beam weighed probably between 250, maybe 300 pounds. Well, not the weaver beam, but the sword or spear he carried. No matter how much his shield weighed. His armor weighed more than most men. So when he would stand out and offer his challenge, Israel would fall back. Everybody would fall back except for this young man, the young sheep herder, who just came to bring some refreshment to his brothers. And he saw and was ashamed at his people. Who is this circumcised Philistine that would dare insult the armies of God? You know the rest of that story. 5 stones, and he only needed one. 5 stones and a sling. David killed Goliath. And it's not ha-ha funny, but it's funny that as soon as Goliath fell, all of a sudden now Israel gets strong. And they attack the Philistines. What that young sheepherder did, emblazoned the strength and the fortitude of his fellow kinsmen and Jews to engage in battle and to defeat the Philistines. You know, someone asked me one time, could anybody have done it? Sure. It had to be someone that had faith, like David, and confidence. Imagine the faith and confidence that David had to have, not only in God, but himself. He had a lot of confidence in God, a lot of confidence in himself that he could direct that stone where it needed to go. This one who would defy the armies of the living God would be the same one that David would behead with his own sword. Gideon is a story I really like. He counted the cost and found, or God did, that he had way too many soldiers. So he put them through a series of tests, told some of them that they could go home, and some of them left and went home. Then the last one was, okay, get a drink of water. So he took them to the bank of a body of water, and they got down. Some of them lapped like a dog, and some of them got down and just pulled the water, pushed the water to the face with their hands. He said, those are the men we want. 300. Now Gideon is about to take 300 men into battle against 1,000. You know, what kind of strategy is that? Then their strategy was, okay, we're going to break up into three groups, 100 per group, surround the Midianites, and then when I give the word, you'll have trumpets and pitchers. Not pictures, pitchers. When this happens, you throw down the pitcher, start yelling and screaming, blowing on the trumpet. That was your strategy for battle. That was it. Kind of like Jericho. Is that it? Yep, that's it. Now, they did it. What if, just out of curiosity, what if Gideon said, no, I'm not doing that. I'm keeping the 2,000 to go with me, and I want to make sure that we are battle ready. What do you think would have happened? Remember Ai? They were defeated because why? They didn't obey God. No doubt in my mind they would have been defeated had Gideon not did it God's way. The end result, whenever all the noise started and the pitchers began to break and the trumpets were sounding and they were yelling and screaming, they thought they were surrounded by multitudes. So much that in their confusion, in the darkness, they began to fight each other. And they were killing each other. And then they began to run, and these 300 chased them to another city. It worked. But it took confidence and bravery. Confidence in God's word and bravery on their part. Be strong. We've already been talking a little bit about strength. Joshua 1 verse 6, be strong and of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Be strong and of good courage. That's a good suggestion and principle for every Christian. Romans 4 verse 20, talk about Abraham. He did not waver in unbelief, but acted strong through faith, giving God the glory. Wax strong through faith. Faith is what gives us our strength. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Faith is the principle by which we're going to obey God and be saved. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13, watch, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men. Not like cowards that the children of Israel presented to the Philistines, but like David. Act like men. Be strong. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 4. Mighty weapons. And he's not talking about the tanks. He's not talking about the jet fighters. He's talking about the faith. The sword of the faith. Or the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. Strong in the faith. Strong in the mind and strong in the spirit. Hebrews 5, verse 13, for everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. You know, if all we do is drink from a shallow well, we're not going to get very strong in the faith. We have to drink deep from the wells of salvation. We've got to drink deep from the wells of God's Word. But solid food belongs to those who are full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Strong meat. You know, I don't know how anyone can exist without eating meat. Eating meat is very important to me because I like it. But you know, when I was born, I didn't eat much meat at the age of 4 months. I didn't eat much meat at the age of a year. But I made up for lost time when I could start eating meat. And still am making up for it. But when you're a babe, that's not something you can do. Young converts, they're not ready for a lot of the meat. But Paul says there comes a time when you are on the soft diet and you ought to be on the meat diet. Because the solid food belongs to those who are of full, complete age. Be strong. Next verse, five. All things, the fifth point, all things in love. Everything that we do should be motivated with the power of love. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, though I have all faith so I can remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Without love, whatever we do for the Lord is useless. Without love, our preaching is nothing. Without love, our good deeds goes for nothing. Without love, we're basically wasting our time. Oh, I know. It could be a good thing. But for the individual that's not practicing with love, his actions are worthless. 1 John 3, verse 1, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. The world is loveless, not the Christian. The world is loveless because it doesn't know God. Therefore, it doesn't love God. But behold, what manner of love the Father had bestowed upon us. Verse 11 of 1 John 3. For this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. If we're going to love God, we should love the children of God. There's our motivation for what we do. First John 3, verse 18. My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. It's so easy to tell people, I love you. But folks, that's not enough. We show them. You know, whenever I was much younger, I was drugged, screaming and kicking and scarring the floor with my heels. My wife grabbed me by the hair of the head and said, we're going to this marriage class. I went. And you know what? I learned a lot. I didn't think they could teach me anything, but I learned a lot. One of the things that I learned was it wasn't enough to tell your bride, I love you. They have to see it. Words are nothing. There has to be some action behind those words. Like faith, the same way. You say you have faith, good deal. Even the devils believe and tremble. Faith comes with works. Love comes with works. First John 5, verse 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. You know why they're not burdensome? Because they come to us via his love. He loved us enough that he wants us to come to heaven with him. And it's through his words that it's going to happen. Plus one. I said there's 5 points plus one. Now we'll get to plus one. It talks about the household of Stephanas. How that they were devoted to serve. That word devoted is a very interesting word. In fact, I believe it's the King James Version renders it addicted to service. The etymology of this word is amazing. I really love the etymology because it adds a lot to what Paul is saying here. Originally, it meant to raise dust by hastening, so that you are hurriedly raising dust in your service to others. So the household of Stephanas was hurriedly addicted to service. Now this is one addiction, folks, that's good. That we all need to be addicted to. Addicted to serve, like the household of Stephanas. Tonight we are hopefully recognizing that to be a Christian, we are to be aggressive. We are to watch. We're to stand fast in the faith. We are to be strong, be brave, and to serve. So you see, it's not just a passive religion, as a lot of people want to make it so. It is not. We're not on the sidelines watching. We're out in the middle of the battleground fighting. Tonight, if you're not a Christian, I'd encourage you, before you can enter into the battle, you've got to adorn yourself with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Repent of your sins. Be baptized, have your sins washed away. Come unto Him with faith, believing. If you are not a Christian tonight, you have this opportunity to become one. Christian, if you have a need where you need to come tonight, we encourage you to do so for prayer as we stand and sing together.
Here is it for thee.